today, the last Sunday in the month of September, he stands in the midst of your people. We ask you to make him available, spirit, soul, and body, and let the environment be conducive for your spirit to flow. At the end of the day, you have reason to say thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Let us believe in Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Really a beautiful day. A day I'm particularly happy to see the joy in the house. It's also my daughter's birthday. So Chioma, she's one of our strong characters in the family. She's in school, so I really want to thank the Lord for giving her another year. Praise the Lord. You know, brethren, what has brought me here today is just a statement that I made in passing. And, you know, our God is agile. If there's one thing you know about Him, He's very active. He's not a dullard. He's smart. He's perfect, he's alert, and he knows indeed whatever it is we're discussing. And whenever he picks up something you are doing, one of the experiences I have had is that it means God wants to do something for you. He doesn't have anything to do. He's busy. I mean, when you look at science and look at what he tells you about what is going on around the world, the universe, there's so much to hold everything together. I don't know how many of us know that as we stay here now, our world is turning in two ways. It's going like this and it's going like this. And it's going like this round the sun. And it's turning at the same time on another end. That's why you have what we call the poles, not poles, south pole. It's constantly moving. And as we stand where we are in the world, there are stones that are flying around the space. Some of the stones are bigger than this house. Some of the stones are bigger than, I'm looking at what I can use as an example, massive stones. And they are going through space. And I can tell you, if there's one worry that scientists have, it is that let this stone not come to Earth. Science says that in the past, there have been stones that came to Earth. They call them meteorites. And even if it's as small as this table, when it's moving in space and it comes to our atmosphere, the science students here will know there are things that surround the Earth, several kinds of atmosphere, stratosphere. I'm not bad science, so I only know what my son is telling me. But I do know that there are atmospheres. And when it's going through each atmosphere, it goes like fire. It is massive speed. Some of them are moving with what you might call speed of light. Massive speed. So when it lands in anywhere, it is like nuclear bomb. Boom. And everything in that neighborhood. Now, some scientists have said the first deluge, you know, that Noah's flood. Some scientists are saying, oh, there was a meteorite that landed on Earth. And that was what, because they say we used to have animals that were massive, you know, what are the names now? Mammoth. You know, this elephant we see now, that is so big on Earth now, it's supposed to be one of the smallest mammals at the time. There were ones bigger than it, but they said it wiped off. Now, that's science. That's not really what I really came to. And I just wanted to let you know that God is busy. He's busy on so many things. So it's not like he's sitting down and just not having time. So when God intervenes in my affair, when he intervenes in your affair, it means he wants to do something good. And that was what it was that my wife and I were just talking gently. We came to fellowship one day, and as we were leaving, yes, we dance and we sing. But as we're living, we felt there was heaviness, there was burden. People could dance, but when you talk with people, one or two, three persons, you know, people are carrying massive things, you know, weight. People, that day, as we left here, I felt people were discouraged. I I was wondering, you know, about it. I was just thinking about it. And, you know, we are Christians. One of the things about Christians is that we are known to be people who have all our worries are given to the Lord. So we're supposed to be happy people, you know, joyful people, and people who are living on the promise that God has given. I'm sure all of us know that, Philippians 4:19. Anybody help me with it? My God shall supply all my needs according to his riches in glory. So, that's a promise. And like somebody was saying today, God keeps his promise. When I was looking at that Philippians 4:9, I looked for the NLT translation. And it says something quite the way I like it. It says, and this same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from his glorious riches which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. So you see, we have reason to be joyful. We have reason not to have heaviness. We have reason to be hopeful. But what you and I have seen, let me limit it to Nigeria that we live in today. What we have seen is as if poverty camps at the door of people, just looking for how to destroy them. Try to say, yeah, you're a Christian, but this body, this wahala will continue. It will destroy you. And when I use poverty, it's not only about money. For some, the poverty is about children. Yes, some want to have children, and yes, they are still, they are Christians and they are praying about it. For some, it's about having a child that you are comfortable with, because some people have children and those children are giving them more, not, I don't say white hair, but I have white hair. So I'll be careful. It's not white hair because my hair is wisdom hair, isn't it? This is wisdom. But you know what I mean. Some people have children that they have prayed about and they are having nightmares. Some people, and these are Christians I'm talking about, I'm not talking about people outside Christianity, household of God. It's about having their own life partner. Sometimes I ask my wife that, I know some females who are some of the nicest females I ever know. And yet, it looks like the guys, the glasses they are wearing is faded. They can't seem to see these wonderful females who fear God. And they are all in the house of the Lord. Sickness, death, accidents, kidnapping. In Nigeria today, all of these things have become commonplace, isn't it? You hear, I mean, Brother Ambrose was talking about even sharing his testimony now. Kogi State, I think that was what he said. Now, Kogi is a place where some of us used to travel when you are going to Abuja, just enter with the bar, going to Kogi. Kogi might even be far. Owerri here was where some of us at 6 p.m. let me just get to the village and you go. Now, I don't know how many people can do that. Brother Damian, I don't really. He's my way, brother. I know before you go now, you have to think a bit. Bam. You know, and it is all over Nigeria. And I dare say, brethren, it is all over the world. There seems to be a battle. The government of the day in almost all the countries of the world seem to be fighting even their own citizens. And those who we trust said that, okay, let's push these people in. When they get there, they make things better. I'm just trying to let you see the picture of the world we are in today. I'm not a pessimistic person. Any person who knows me knows that I'm quite optimistic. But look at what is going on now. And it is affecting not just unbelievers, because sometimes you think unbelievers are the ones who deserve to be dealt with. But it's affecting Christians who really just want to do good. Even those who are working in a place where sometimes you don't know whether the company or your organization wants you to be there. They seem to do things to knock you out. Now, all of this just makes me ask the question that day. So what happens to the days of Elijah? Remember when that man of God, Uncle Elijah, stood and caused fire, and it happened instantly? What happened to those days when Uncle Paul was preaching and one young child that was listening fell off from the story building and died? And Brother Paul went to him, prayed over him, and went back to what he was preaching, and that boy got up. He didn't even think too much about it. There was somebody I think you all know who, when they called him and said, "You need to pay tax," what did he do? He just told his, "Go to that river, keep one fish, open the mouth, and you found money," and he paid the tax. People worked and got good harvest. So I just asked myself, is it that our sins are heavier than those people's sins? Our prayers, are they not as powerful as those people's prayers? Some people used to tell us that heaven used to be closer to hell before. Was it their time? And our own time, heaven seemed a bit far. Why does it appear that our prayers are not answered, or at least not as quickly as you and I want them to be answered? Brethren, I have asked these questions, and I think they are legitimate questions. I know people who have asked these questions. Does it make our faith smaller? Does it make my faith less? Does it make me less a Christian? I don't think so. I don't think the Lord doesn't want us to ask questions. I believe strongly that He does want us to ask questions. So, my wife and I were just chatting, husband and wife talking. But you know, when God gets into your conversation, then God is in your marriage. So we were talking and we left it at that, and I went to take my bath the next day. And while I was where I was taking my bath, he began the conversation with me. I didn't realize immediately that it was a conversation. I just dropped something and it began. And you know, God is interesting. You have what you think you are doing, that you think this is what it is. Even now, yes, I've written some things down. But believe me, my heart is so open that if He pushes me, I'll go off everything that I may have written down and speak as He pushes my heart. So please pardon me. I'm not speaking that I have the answer, but I'm sharing with you some of the experiences that I have had with Him. And it happened to be one day we woke up in the morning and I just got up from bed and wanted to go about preparing for the day. And I just heard a word, Obato Joba Bioba. Now, is there anybody who speaks Yoruba here who can just give me, I'm glad if you don't know about it now. Obato Joba Bioba. Anybody?
The God that is greater than any other God.
You are almost correct. Almost correct. Any other person who speaks, who can? It's a statement that I've never heard before and checked on the internet, I'm not seeing it. So I'm just curious if somebody else may have heard it before. Now, Oba is Yoruba word for king. So Joba is who reigns or who rules, be Oba like a king. So he says he's the sovereign, you know, Oba, well, I don't know the kind of Obas we have now. This is a non Oba talk. Somebody can stand up and say, Oba, sit down there. But you know, in those days when we read, when women were won by men who deserved them, in those days, when a king talks, in fact, if you're a beautiful woman, you be careful, go around where the king is. In your body, say, oh, God bless him. He has placed his leg on the woman. So even if he's married, Baba says, this woman is my wife. She moves to his house. How are you doing? But that was power. That was power. But even the most powerful king in those days, even the most powerful emperor, and I'm trying to find an example of a king that was extremely powerful. Nebuchadnezzar was so powerful that he built a statue and said, everybody bow. And everybody was bowing except those young boys. Now, God Almighty said, even Nebuchadnezzar, as powerful as he was, some three boys would tell him, and he couldn't do anything. And we all read the story. Nebuchadnezzar showed that he was a king, powerful, but he didn't have all power. When God says he is Oba, Toji Oba, Bi Oba, he says that he is the sovereign king who reigns the way a king reigns. I pray you have a bit more understanding of what he has said. So when that sovereign king who reigns the way a king reigns comes to your affair, when he comes into your matter, he will do it the way he knows how to do it. He will do it the way he wants to do it. He will do it not caring, because other kings, other obas, they will die. Other obas only know as far as their advisors tell them. Buhari will blame him so much, but the truth of the matter is, he probably doesn't even know Jack. He doesn't know what the price of gas is. So he depends on what they are telling him. But we have a father who is almighty, who is a king, who sits on the throne. And where he's sitting, he knows what is happening to you, to you, to you. He knows that, in fact, he said somewhere that not even one hair of your head will fall to the ground. So, brethren, may this almighty God intervene in your matter in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I know that when he does that, it is for our good. So, like I said, the next day, he started talking to my heart about the conversation we had the day before. And the question was, what should a Christian do? What can a Christian do after you have repeatedly prayed to God? Yes, the scripture tells us about the lady who knocked and the judge said, no, this woman will not let me rest. I'll answer what she needs. Yes. So when you've done that, you've knocked and knocked and knocked. You've prayed and prayed and prayed. And you are not carrying, you know, there's no burden of sin that you can say, okay, this is what is holding me. If there's a burden of sin, you have an excuse, right? You say, okay, maybe it's because of this that happened. When you know you've cleared your plates and you've prayed and it's still not happening, what should you do? What can you do? Let's look at Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7. If it's possible, Philippians 4, 6 and 7, if it's possible, I will like to put it on, but I just read it quickly, if whichever one works. Okay. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Yes, please. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guide your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. The person who has house rent to pay, do you have peace when you know that your landlord has told you that tomorrow morning I'm coming to deal with you? The person whose child is in the hospital. Brother, I know a bit of what I'm saying. I've knelt down in public, raised my hand and said, Lord, I don't want, I mean, sorry I mentioned it, but you all were here the day, how many years ago, 13 years ago, when my son was being born, and they brought him out, and it was about the life of my dear wife. And the doctors had raised their hands and said, it looks like there's nothing more. And thank God, normally you switch off your phone, but thank God, that day, I think it was Sister Roberta's phone that was open. And she mentioned it quickly, and the congregation went into prayers. But why do I mean that? I knelt down in my office, openly, near the clinic, maternity ward. And I raised my hand and said, Lord, I don't want to raise this student without this woman. That was the only prayer I could make because I was in that state. Today I'm grateful you heard me. I'm really grateful you heard me. It wasn't immediate, but I'm grateful you heard me. So when you have that in mind, you really have peace. I'm just putting myself in that position. I'm asking you to please put yourself in that position. Do you really have peace which surpasses all understanding under that condition? But brethren, I feel that the Lord God wants to tell us something about this, the weight that you and I are carrying in this time. If you're a Nigerian, you are carrying weight. Forget it. No matter how much money you have, no matter where you live, no matter what influences you have, you are carrying a weight. We were told of a gentleman who was friends to generals and friends to whom Mr. President, for whom COVID caught, was in Lagos, a rich man who was really wealthy, and they went to hospitals. They couldn't take him in, not because of lack of money. They needed a place that had oxygen. And at the time in this nation, in this world, not the other nation, oxygen was scarce. And it just happened that that was when that man died. He had all the money and all the influence. So you have imagined, including the president said, fly him abroad. Maybe there was not enough time. Whatever it was, it caught him at that time. But I do know that the Lord wants to tell us something about the weight we are carrying. I've mentioned some weights, but it's possible I didn't mention your own. That's my I didn't get a list from the Lord to share with you. So he knows the one you are carrying, and he just wants you to put that weight in that list of what it is he wants to talk about. Because he wants you to know that the God of the whole earth is thinking about you. Amen. The God of the whole earth is thinking about you. The God of the universe. Let me rephrase that. Because if you say earth, you and I were thinking of east, west, north, and south. But just a few months ago, we were told that 3 spacecrafts traveled and got to a place called Mars. No human being has gone to Mars. We used to read about it and we thought it was just one of those Superman kind of stories. But today we know that there's a place called Mars. We have sent spaceship there and it is there. And that place is ruled by God. He made the universe and it is His. Something I saw while I was looking through, that God is thinking about you. In the Acts 17, 20, verse 27, I will just read it here. He says, He is not far from any of us. It's a longer part, but the part that I really want to bring out is Acts 17, verse 27. He says, He is not far from any of us. That's what the Lord God says. Matthew 20 verse 20, it's not your own Matthew chapter, but it's still the same Matthew. Matthew 20 verse 20 says, And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. I have used this several times. Matthew 20, 20. Sorry? 28, 20, oh, I'm sorry. Thank you very much for the correction. 28, 20, yes. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. This has encouraged me several times when things have happened. So, if I thought this was just me having conversation with my wife and just thinking, imagine my excitement when you came for the marriage group. If you were not here that day, you missed it. I think you should ask Julie and the marriage committee to do another Part 2. You know, you have a football match, Part 1 and first half and second half. Please think about second half. If you were not here, you missed. But it was at that marriage group that I just whispered to Moni Joyce and said, the Lord said something to me that I think might be useful to talk about. And she said, okay. Yeah, she now called me back and said, do you know that I had wanted to call you to come and teach? Right, ma'am? And when I heard that, I was excited because it meant it wasn't my heart talking to myself, that the Lord actually has something to tell us. And for me, that experience is something that repeatedly happens intermittently, not very often. I think I've shared with you once where I was in a bus in Lagos, you know, those days of working in the bank. Any morning you come to Jujubega, enter bus to Island, and it was like a pilgrimage. Everybody seemed to be going the same way, so bus look and be crazy. So in order to get to Island on time, you left your home by 5 a.m. or thereabout. If you don't live in Lagos, you don't know what you are missing. You are missing. So now I hear it's 4:30 even. People live around that time now. But in my own time, it was about 5 a.m. You just try to get to enter the bus so that by 6 you have reached a part of the Tottenham Bridge. Then you begin the slow movement. It's not so heavy then. So that day I was just in the bus. It was a Monday morning. And I saw, it wasn't bright, it was still dark. And I saw everybody in the bus. I just felt like I felt about the fellowship this day I'm talking about. I just felt that day that everybody in that bus was worried about what the day would be like, what was going to happen. And in my own conversation, in my heart, I just said, poor people, if only they knew that our Lord Jesus Christ has taken care of the thing they are worried about. So I said it to my heart and I thought I was. Then I just heard a small word that is true, if only they knew that Jesus has taken care of. I said, yes, so somebody asked. I said, if only they knew. He said, somebody should tell them. I said, true, somebody should tell them. In Lagos, it was normal in those days. Somebody just get up in the bus and start preaching. It was normal. I don't know about now. When he said, somebody should tell them, I said, yes, so I just want somebody to tell them. He said, so why don't you tell them? Here. Now, you know, I have a Catholic background. So Catholic people, we don't, in the past, we don't get up to go out to say, praise the Lord, somebody, I want to know. Because, and me, I had a particular worry. Brother, that thing you said, where is it in the Bible? Well, I'm not brother, I'm a magical. So because of that, of course, some of us had morbid fear of preaching in public. But when he said that to me, I argued with the Lord. That was when I knew that it was the Lord talking. I said, bam, 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 not. So I didn't have peace till I got to Ireland. I went about my work. The next morning, as I entered bus in that same place, he came again and said, shouldn't you talk to them about what you said yesterday? So I said, no. And this thing I'm saying, no. The bus fills up and is moving. So eventually, by the time I got to a part of the tunnel called K2, for those of you who know that side. And you know, these buses are not easy buses. They are buses where the driver is blasting Fuji music. Everybody is talking and all. So when he said that, eventually I had no peace. So I said, Lord, if I do it now, there won't be enough time. So let me do it tomorrow. He said, okay. And he said, okay. So I chilled. And by the next morrow that I was talking about, I wasn't thinking about it in the office, so I wasn't thinking about it at home. As I just sat down to the bus, he said, you will do it today. I didn't tell you, that day before, when I negotiated tomorrow, he got to his state, he said something that I will never forget. He said, you don't want to preach because you are looking at their faces. If you look at their faces, I will confound you. Up to that time, I don't think I thought about that word confound. But that day, he said, I will confound you. So that was when I became afraid. And I said, Lord, I'll do it, but let me do it tomorrow. And he agreed. And I had peace. And the next day, I came into the bus. Without thinking about it, as I sat, I just said, you will do it today. So I said, yes. But Lord, let the conductor collect his money so that he can be slow. And he said, okay. And the bus moved. So the conductor was, collecting money, disturbed everybody. The driver was particularly blasting Fuji music. It was high music. When the conductor collected and sat down, and knew there was no more. It was either you do it or you don't do it. So I didn't realize that I was sitting behind the driver. I didn't realize until that time. So I just whispered and said, "Oh boy, your buffet." Before I said buffet preach, the driver turned off the music completely. What I was telling him was lower it, but he turned it off completely, and the rest is history. I preached that day, the next day, the third day, and it has been different from then on. So when the Lord does that, you know He has indeed something to do. And there's always a benefit for you. Always a benefit. I won't bother you with why the benefit I got from preaching for 3 days. I got a benefit that is still living with me today. Those who know, if you know, you know. I should tell you, I got my wife. I got my wife because her boss was in the vehicle. I didn't know she was there. So when she got to the office, she said, "Ah, see, you say this guy not be Christian, but look at what he was doing in the bus." I think that was one of his time that beautiful woman began to look at me and say, "Yeah." But brethren, there is always a benefit when the Lord gives you that. If you kindly put first, if you kindly put Joshua chapter 1, verse 7 to 9. Joshua chapter 1, verse 7 to 9. You know, while he's doing that, whenever the Lord says something to me, this is my own personal interpretation of something that you always see. The scripture says, "God has spoken once. I have heard this twice. That power belongs to God." I don't go to that place where say power belongs to God. The one I pick is, "God has spoken once. Me, I will hear it 2 times. Which means, I better move and do." That's my own interpretation, and that's been very helpful to me. So Joshua also heard the Lord in Joshua 1, verse 7 to 9. He said, "Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from me to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success." And yes, have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. So when the Lord asks us to do something, 2 things he'll give with us. Secondly, he'll give a benefit. That's personally I have seen over and over and over again. I'm sure if I ask us here, we probably will have experiences on these outlines here. So brethren, irrespective of where you live, where you are, which country you are in, I know some of us here are international citizens, but irrespective of where you are, there's a dilemma all of us are having to answer. There was somebody who faced a dilemma like that. By the way, dilemma means a situation in which you have to make difficult choices and you have two or more alternatives. So that's what dilemma means. So should I do this or should I do that? We all have that dilemma. Especially, and I would like you to please put at the back of your mind what I've described about what is going on in the world, our world right now. It may be difficult in the world, but in Nigeria, I have a feeling somebody has increased the fire by 7, the type that Shadrach and Abednego had to face. But thanks be to God, there's a 4th man in that fire. Let them increase the fire however they want to, but there's a 4th man in that fire, and that 4th man is for us. That 4th man is for us in Jesus' name. So in Genesis 26, don't show it because it's a long one. I'll just a quick summary. In that Genesis 26, our patriarch Isaac was faced with his own dilemma. Whether to go to Egypt, because of the famine that was going on in Canaan at that time, or to stay in Canaan. And staying in Canaan was almost like signing a death warrant, that it was a slow death, because famine was really bad. I don't know if all of us know that story, that when he was preparing himself to go, what happened? The Lord called him. and said, "Oh God, stay here. I promised this land to your father, Abraham. Stay here." In fact, one pastor was preaching on this, and he said, God told him, "Oh God, that Egypt where you go, I'm the God of that place. I'm the one who made that place wealthy. Stay here, I will make you wealthy." We know the story because that place he stayed, Isaac became so wealthy that the kings of the area were afraid of him. He would dig a well, they would close it. Even the wells that his father Abraham dug, they went and poured sand. And if you know, this area is, water is critical. Like who was teaching the other day that when they went to look for a wife for Isaac, Rebecca, that the servant that Abraham sent said, "Lord, the woman who will water my camel, who will give me water and water my camel, is the one you've chosen." That looks like it's an easy thing because you think upon Mary, water, no one. Check out. They said one camel will need 10 gallons of water. So that young lady, she must have come from somewhere, I don't know, decided to give the man water without the man asking. Gave the man's camels, and I think I heard the man had about, is it 4 or 10 camels or something like that? 10 camels. So imagine, 10 gallons times 10. If you are a father to that girl, you put your flood and say, "Yeah, I sent you back here, water, where have you been since?" But the young lady was working because she was under the unction of somebody higher than her father, who she may not even have known. But that God had plans for someone that girl to be connected to, and he moved. So maybe, in fact, this is why I'm going off what I've written. One of the things I learned is that a lot of times we probably blame God that we have problems and he hasn't solved it. Brethren, look at yourself. Maybe 6 months ago, 5 months ago, 2 years ago, the Lord did something, told you to do something that was going to prepare you for what problem you were facing today. But you didn't, either you didn't take it up or you ignored it. It's my postulation, but please think about it. Personal experience, I didn't have a job 1 year in Lagos, and I was indeed looking for work. As a matter of fact, I was arrogant because I had worked in a bank. I was so good in the bank that people from other banks were going to ask me how I did what I did. So I was confident when the bank asked me to go for insubordination. I said to myself, in no time at all, I'll get another job. I stayed 6 months. I didn't have a job. And yes, money was not heavily the problem, but my mom was working there and she was always sending me these, you know, any parent here, yeah, please, if you have a son who is undergoing that you need to be sending, please don't send the money. A day is coming, that child shall pay you back the 100-fold in Jesus' name. Please don't be discouraged. My mom was sending me money. And I had worked for about 9 years. But I didn't see what it was that I worked with. But that year, that's 2000, year 2000, that day, I had gotten so broke that I agreed for my alumni association. I went to Isuka and we have an alumni association in Lagos. They said, "Oh, we need someone who go to the office of Prince Tony Momo." I didn't have a job. I didn't have money, so I accepted that I would go. My reason was, at least that transport money they will give me, I will have something left for my pocket. So I went to Prince Tony Momo's office in Antony Village, if you know Lagos. Now, why am I telling this story? I was dressed in suits. I had been a banker, so I wore suits. To see, one of the things you learn as a banker is dress well, because you don't know when opportunity will come. But as I got to Tony Momo's office, came out, did what I was doing, came out, and I was going back to Antony. I didn't have a car, so I was walking in my suits under the sun, afternoon of Lagos, and I was walking to the bus stop, and I was just thinking to myself, look at me. I'm telling you as I was, look at me. I am one of the best in the world that I do. And here I am, 6 months, no job. And there were, and you know, the devil is interested, he'll tell you that there are some other guys who are not as good as you, and they are doing very well. So I was saying, what all this? Then he entered my mind and said, this is the kind of thing that makes some people say they'll kill themselves. I thought of that. Yes, maybe I didn't think I would kill myself, but I thought of it that this has made some people to kill themselves, that what's life? And things were not looking good at all. As a matter of fact, all the relationships I had died. Even my male friends who used to come to see me in the bank because of contracts died. Nobody, as a matter of fact, only one guy was always, and today he became my best man at my wedding. But I was that depressed. And as I said that afternoon, I didn't realize that I had gotten so deep in thoughts that I wasn't even seeing what was going on around. But I saw the figure of a female coming, but I didn't focus on it. So I was walking on the side of the road. And as she passed me, the lady said something. So that's what she said. Jacked me up and I turned. She didn't stop, she was moving on. So I stopped, I said, sorry, what did you say? She said, I like your suits. So I started laughing. I said, in my mind, I said, look at suit that is not even brand new. It was even made in Nigeria. And it's not something that, I've been using it for a long while. It's what somebody's liking. So I said, thank you. And as she said it, she was moving on, she didn't even stop. So as I turned to continue my way, I heard a statement that has stayed with me. This was 2000. My children know this. We are not like them who do not have hope. Brethren, search your Bible. The closest you will find is where it talks about we shouldn't mourn like people who do not have hope. In I think that's Thessalonians. So somebody, yes, that's the closest. I've used the internet to search, which tells me that the Lord spoke to me that day. He says, we're not like them who do not have hope. And that energized me. And that day, I got a message from two friends. From one friend who had gone to two other friends. And he said he had asked them that he was based in the US, that he has a company in Nigeria, he's going back, he needs somebody to run it. And two different persons said, go and look for Michael Adande. I got a job, it was just a small job. He was paying me 10% of what I was earning in the bank. But guess what, brethren? That job taught me how to use computer so well that by the time I came 2 years later for a job in an international air company, I was one of the few persons who could use the computer. So I passed the interview flying. What am I saying? Please, do not discountenance the small things that the Lord brings to your way. Whatever he's telling you to do that does not make sense to you. As long as you know it is the Lord, though, a brother, a sister may prophesy and tell you. Like I think mommy always tells us, we are all children of God. There's no grandchild of God. Is there any grandchild of God here, people? So we all should have relationship with the Lord enough that when Baramati tells me something, not to discard what he's saying, I must go and cross-check with the Lord. He's my father. He will also tell me, yes, that thing I told him, that after he told him, I told him. You never can tell. That might be the thing that will sort out the situation that you will be facing in the future. It's never too late, but we are there, and the Lord will help us. Now, for those who say they are Christians, and they are good, they've been faithful to the Lord, and they have prayed, and things are not working out well. Hold on. Have you wondered how Joseph must have felt when Potiphar's wife was dealing with him? Joseph was a good guy. He knew his God. He obeyed the laws of God. He didn't touch the woman, but he ended up in jail, wasn't he? Didn't he? And we know what happened to him. Even in the jail, he still kept on believing God. And he became good in the prison. He was so good that he became the general overseer of prison environment. So good that he even interpreted dreams. So if you think, maybe I'm not succeeding because I don't have connections. Joseph had connection. He had connection to somebody who was grateful to him for getting back to the highest man in his country, the king, the friend of his time. But when the guy got there, he forgot Joseph. How do you think Joseph must have felt? You know, we told ourselves the story of Elijah, 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 1 to 3, where after he had done, 1 Kings 18, where he had done wonderful things, he called on fire, he killed all the prophets of Baal. He was, in fact, not only prophets of Baal, there's another set of prophets, Asher. He killed all of them. So he was cleansing the land for God's people. So he should be, that should be when he should feel it. And he was up, I mean, correct guy. But guess what? Scripture tells us that when Ahab told Jezebel everything that Elijah did, and she sent word to him that maybe God was giving the feeling, and ever so severely, give by this time tomorrow, I did not make your life like the wife of those who killed. Elijah became scared and ran, was looking for where to. In fact, he even told God, boom, I've done enough, and all of that. We often sing, Paul and Silas, they prayed, they sang, the Holy Ghost came down. Shall we like to sing so loud? If you look at the verse before that place, you will see that Paul and Silas, I'm talking about Acts chapter 16, 25 and 22 was when we were singing, but look at 22 to 24. You will see the scripture tells us that, first of all, the crowd attacked Saul and Paul and Silas. The magistrate said they should strip them and beat them with rods. Then they punched their faces. Then they threw them into prison. Now when I saw that prison, I said, okay, let me go and check. You know, in America, they say people go to prison and then they have PhD while they're in prison. They go to school. So I went to check the prison at the time of Paul. This is the description I got from Google. He said, prison will be filthy, underground, and hot. Oftentimes, prisoners will be tortured into revealing information, and this only served the ulterior motive of deterring crime. So, Paul was not in an air-conditioned office when he was singing and praying. He must have been depressed. Of course, you know later on in the scripture, he tells us how many times he had been beaten, shipwrecked, all of those kind of things. But he chose, with his brother Silas, to praise God. And to pray to God. So by now, brethren, I'm really trying to round up now. By now, I have a feeling you have an idea of what the Lord is expecting of us. But I ask, there's just some quick questions. Do you really believe in God? Please, you don't need to answer me or raise your hand, but answer it yourself. Yes, we're Christians. Some of us were born into Christian homes, some of us became Christians after experiencing, you hate us all. But do you believe in God? Really? When God said our sins are forgiven us, do you believe that? I'm asking that because I believe that's one of the reasons why most of us are here. I do not know if there's any brother or sister here who has not made the altar call. I have a belief that at the end, we will make an altar call for those who want to come up. It's critical. My understanding is very important that you stand before brethren and declare that I'm a Christian. It's critical. It's necessary. So I'm speaking to people who I believe we all have had the opportunity to say that. And we, in doing that, we believe that our sins were forgiven. I think so. Is that right? Now, we believe that. I'm just asking this because if we believe that, if we believe what the Lord says in Matthew chapter 10, verses 29 to 31, that there are two sparrows sold for a penny, yet none of them will fall to the ground apart from the will of our Father, and that the very hair of our heads are all numbered, meaning that God cares about us. If you believe that God has washed our sins away and is forgiving us our sins, is it possible that you believe this other one too, that God says he has numbered our heads, he cares about you time. I hope your answers are yes. If your answers are not yes, may I ask that you please consider it. Please get to the state where your answer can be yes. Because one of the things that the Lord wants me to share with you is that He loves it when we trust Him. It's so important to God that we who say He's our Father. You know, in the old days, they didn't really call God Father. They called Him God. But in our time, because of the mercy of God and the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ, we can call God Father. We who call Him Father, we really need to trust Him. You know, there's a song that the choir sang one of these times. It says, He has a habit of giving His word. Please, the Lord wants us to trust Him. And when you make your request to Him, one of the beautiful things I've enjoyed in the Fonte House is the teaching, and I think Godaiba often does that. If there's something you want, he says, let's find a scripture to tie it to it. Please find a way to make that a habit. When you have a request before the Lord, find a scripture. It may take you longer time. You may need to stop in prayer and go and read your Bible to get it. But please, have a scripture that ties it. It helps to make the Lord. But the Lord says He's happy to hear His own words and He will perform it. Now, when you have that word, especially if the Lord gives you a word that is like no other word, like when He told you we are not like them who do not have hope. Believe me, brethren, things have happened since that time. I always have hope. I am one of the most hopeful people you can ever meet. Not because I have all the answers, but I know that He who said it will do it. Please always sit on those words. And when you pray to Him, it's one of two ways. Either He will give you what you have asked for, or He will not. God that we know will not leave you in darkness. And His response is always towards doing what is best for us. We may not see it because we are limited by our senses, but it's always that. Now, if He says He's going to give you your request, He's the one who will determine the time. And that is where you and I have wahala. You see, I need to pay my rent tomorrow. As far as I'm concerned, what are you talking about God answering me later? Mbambo, I said there used to be a church called Mbambo. For those who used to be in labor, those who go, you know. And maybe they believe they were right, but we know that with time, we see now that we're not exactly right. I leave that for another conversation. But that's where we have wahala. You know, I was looking through and somebody wrote something. He said, is God's timing always right? The person answered, God's timing is always perfect. God is never early, He's never late, but He's always on time. Our timing isn't God's timing. God's perfect timing does two things. It grows our faith as we are forced to wait and trust in God. And it makes certain that He and He alone gets the glory and praise for pulling us through. Brethren, I stayed in one job group in my office. We worked by job group. I stayed in one job group for 13 years. I saw people who I got higher scores than pass me, move on. I saw I was doing jobs that they were telling me that I was doing well, but I didn't get any promotion for 13 years. It wasn't easy. In fact, it was embarrassing because there were people who thought the things I was doing meant I was at a particular high job group. So one guy saw me one day and said, ah, but boy, you when they work with Ogaden, that means you are on, he said, job two, which was pretty high. So I smiled and said, no. He said, hey, okay, so you are on job three. I said, no. I don't think it was at one of my most embarrassing times because people looked at you and thought you were supposed to be somewhere. But I wasn't there. But when it pleased God, when it pleased God that I had given up hope concerning people, and one of the things I didn't do, I didn't go to the offices of God to say, they can promote me now. But in a dream, He showed me I was trying to climb Zuma Rock, if you know the rock in Abuja, and I couldn't get to the top. Then, after a lot of effort, one man at the top stretched his hand and pulled me up. At that time, we were doing the reorganization in the office. I was confident that, since the Lord has spoken, came away, like the name is saying, we say. Unfortunately, the organization happened. I didn't get the promotion. I was sacked. In fact, I think I was getting to the position of being depressed. I have a friend, he's a professor, he used to be with us, but he's gone back to the university. So my wife called him and said, my husband is on my way to home. I'll be glad if you can talk to him. He's a Christian, and I wonder if he will come here to worship with us. So he got in touch with me, I called him, and I told him that, look, prof, my problem is not that I didn't get promotion, but the Lord showed me, and I didn't get it. So he let me interpret it to him. What is it? And he said, well, I'm fine, but it's not over now. When I got that promotion, everybody in my office till date say, oh boy, you are the best man for this job. The last time we did reorganization, we just ended a few months ago. I was one of the few persons in that company that they told, don't worry, your job and you are okay. Others, I'm sure that all of you have heard about the glory shape. People were worried, people had high blood pressure, people went to hospitals. I mean, I don't know about colleagues who fell sick because their job was threatened. But the Lord gave me peace, that peace he talked about. In the midst of the madness, gave me peace. So his timing is always perfect. Uncle Joe, there's a first, just a quick song. If you do not have time, okay, but maybe I've just read the song, but he would share with us later on if it's possible. When they talk about God's timing is at his own time. I've taken a lot of time, so I think I'll just pass that place. There's another song that says, the Lord was the one asking. Somebody was going to God about house rent, about the problem. And the person was speaking without believing God. And God said, I don't understand you. Was it not me who walked on water? And that's what he's asking somebody here. Was it not me who walked on water? Was it not me who healed you when you were sick? Was it not me who settled you in various other challenges you have? That you had and you came out, you even didn't realize you had big problems. You know, the Bible says that when the Lord turned the captivity of the children of Israel, there were the people who were in dream. Many of us here, I perceive, have escaped problems that we didn't even know how we got out of it. And then, because you now have a current problem, you forgot. That's all. If you could, maybe you could take later on, I have not taken time. But please, brethren, the Lord wants us to trust Him. And when you pray, and indeed you need to wait a little while, wait is not a problem. Many people, the problem is that what a little while they are waiting. What me I have done. When I have spoken to the Lord about what is critical to me, and I have repeated my prayers, and my family, we've talked about it. Brethren, I begin to look at what else I should be doing, maybe not even for myself, it will be somebody who has another need. And in many cases, my challenge, I don't actually call it problem, my challenge gets resolved. Many cases, so if you have a problem that you have spoken to the Lord about, because you trust Him and you've presented it to Him with prayer, thanksgiving, brethren, look for somebody who needs help. Begin to help that person. You will have solution to your situation. You will have solution to your situation. Is it not in the scripture? The woman was told, just go and prepare that food for me. And in the process, her own problem got resolved beyond one day. Yes, to be careful, know where who you are supporting, know where you are going to share some of these thoughts. Be wise, be close to the Lord. But hey, is true. And the last point that I'll just say is that there's no solution anywhere else. Brethren, there's no, I'm not saying, I thank God that this place is not one particular church. We are not a church as, you know, Catholic, Redeemed, people like, no. So we are here because we believe in the Lordship of our Lord Jesus Christ. That is the only solution. That is the only place there is. If you ever moved somewhere else, may the Lord forgive you and forgive me. But stick to this that we are talking about. The Lord, recently I sent a message that the Lord whispered, I mean, he spoke to my ear. He said, the Lord, their God, is their Father. Again, I've searched, thank God for the internet, I've searched to see if it's written anywhere in those said that way. I didn't find it. So the Lord, I thought it was for the house, for the fellowship, but when I sent it to Mommy Ann, she said, she perceived that it was for me and my family. But I'm sharing it with you. The Lord, our God, is also our Father. Please think about this, ruminate over it. Because me, I've searched all over, I've gone high and low. Brother Brandy, are you here? Please just run it off with us for that place. Search all over.
Couldn't find nobody. I look high and low. Still couldn't find nobody. Nobody great. Nobody great. Nobody greater than you. Searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody great, nobody great, nobody greater than you. Couldn't find nobody.
Can you add some to this mic? Hallelujah. Let's appreciate God. Let's appreciate God. I titled this teaching Sovereign King, based on the Yoruba, the Sovereign King. There are some questions our brother asks towards the end. Do you really believe in God? Do you believe when He says that your sins are forgiven? And do you believe He cares for you? Actually, this question is not just for unbelievers, also believers. Hallelujah. Yesterday we visited a family that is passing through some challenge. And this is a woman I can call mother in Israel. But she said, God has disappointed me. Sometimes you think you know God, and you face a challenge, you will understand that. Deep down in your heart, they will call you a big man of God, but in your heart, you are not. You are actually feeling disappointed. I like us as we are standing. I don't know what you are passing through. I don't know what you are passing through. But if you feel that God has disappointed you, I think it's important you make it up. Because He says something that it is important we come to where we can truly say, God, I trust you. That thing is easy when you have not passed through situations. There are situations you will get across, it will be difficult to tell God you trust Him. But it doesn't matter what we are passing through now, if you are feeling that God has disappointed you, or you have lost your trust in God, situations are so critical. I think it is important that we come forward. Just stand by the altar. Don't look at anybody. Don't look at anybody. I was listening to a man of God, part of the prayer we prayed earlier on. He said, until your situation comes into your life, when others will be celebrating and you are at the altar, you have not really arrived. Pray that God will push you to a point where when people are celebrating, you are crying at the altar. He said, your Penina. Let God lead you to what? Your Penina. That second wife of Elkanah that mocked Hannah to the point that Hannah will no longer celebrate when others are celebrating. So I want us to come. If you know that when people are celebrating, you can't celebrate. Because there's something unsettled in our life. Just come before the altar of God. Come before the God and say, God, I want to celebrate. It's not about anybody. It's not about anybody. And God told Hannah something. He said, am I not better for you than what? How many children put together? Hannah told him, little by her action, you are my husband, you are not my child. You play a different role, but there's something in my life that you can't fill that gap. Just tell God. Talk to God. God, I'm in a position, I don't know if I trust you. It doesn't matter how well you look at me in the church or fellowship, but Lord, where I am standing now, I don't know if I trust you. Settle with God, talk to Him, talk to Him, talk to Him, talk to Him. Let the same burden that was upon Hannah come upon you. That no celebration will be of any benefit, of any meaning, Because the weight you carry is greater than what the people are celebrating. Another set of people, perhaps this story, this teaching sounds like a story because you do not have any relationship with God. You have come because others are coming. It's a matter of tradition. But today, let there be a contact between you and God. Just come and say, God, people say they hear you. I have not heard you. Or even if I think I heard you, I'm not so sure. But going forward today, I want to be part of those who will testify that I heard the Lord. I heard you, Lord. Just come to the altar and say, Lord, I want to be partakers of those who hear you. I want to hear you for myself. Not what somebody told me, but me for myself. The third question he asks, can you believe that God cares? Yeah, God cares for you. Not a story that somebody told you, but what you have encountered. You say, Lord, yes, you care for me. If you don't believe that he cares for you, by reason of what you are passing through, come to the altar and settle it with him. Settle it with him. And for those of us who feel comfortable standing because God has settled your own case, can you just begin to thank him? Because me, I'm in a state also that I think there are some things I need to settle with God. But for you that everything about you has been settled with God and you can trust him enough, it doesn't matter what it is, appreciate him. Appreciate him. So all of us have a reason to talk to God. Just open our mouth, let's appreciate God, let's appreciate him, let's thank him, let's talk to him. It doesn't matter whether you are praising him or you are telling him, I don't trust you, by reason of what I've been through, I don't think you care for me, by reason of what I've been through, I don't know if you care for me, even if I think, I don't know. I'm having doubt in my heart. Lord, you have disappointed me. Lord, you have failed me. Whatever you want to tell him that is why he's suffering. Let your voice be heard. Don't worry about the person beside you. That person has no problem. You are the one that wants to settle with God. Speak to him. Talk to him.
Yes, Lord, you are the reason.
before the Lord at the altar, I want to believe that that prayer point will not be exhausted right here. But I just want all of us to go according to the topic of the day to understand that God is sovereign. And because He's sovereign, He knows the end from the beginning. And He knows the beginning from the end. And so, having that confidence, even when you don't seem to believe it, we are not of them that lose hope. That is important. Lord, I don't understand. I don't even feel that you trust me, that I trust you, that you love me. But Lord, do not let me lose hope. Let me believe you against my feelings. Let me believe you against what people are telling me. Let me believe you. Just tell him, Lord, I want to believe you. Bring me to the place where I will believe you. Thank you, Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, we want to pray. I like us having answered this altar call and start and touch the altar. Just go back to your seat and then pick your Bible. The brother said, look for a scripture. Let's do some prophetic prayers. And let's come to a place where, by the mercy of God, we pray some prayer in the room. And I believe that when Brother Demian was here at the opening prayer, he opened some of those scriptures. We'll pray them along this day. This is the last Sunday in the month of September. Let's see if we can spend some time and pray. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Isaiah 66, that's where we started. Lord, you are the reason I need. You are the one for me. You are the one for us. Daddy, you are the reason I need.
You are the one for me.
You are
the one for me.
Yes.
Oh, why should I give when I have you?
Certain man of the Ramatan Zophim of the mountains of Ephraim, and his name was Elkanah, the son of Jeroham, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zuph of Ephraimite. An Ephraimite, let's go down. And he had two wives. The name of one was Hannah, and the name of the other, Peninnah. Peninnah had children, but Hannah had no children. Remember, our brother started with poverty, and he explained the different kinds of poverty. Go down. This man went up from his city yearly to worship and sacrifice to the Lord of hosts in Shiloh. Also, the two sons of Eli, Hophni, and Phinehas, the priests of the Lord, were there. And whenever the time came for Elkanah to make an offering, he would give portions to Peninnah, his wife, and to all her sons and her daughters. Underline that, all her sons and her daughters. But to Hannah, he will give a double portion, for he loved her. Underline double portion. Now the scripture is not so clear whether the double portion was all the portions he gave to the wife and the children and the sons, he will combine and give Hannah, or that he gives Hannah just two persons ration. We don't know. For he loved her, although the Lord had closed her womb. I like to underline the word closed her womb. Sometimes certain doors close because God, what God wants to bring out of you is greater than all together, whatever your neighbor had. Praise the Lord. And her rival also provoked her severely to make her miserable because the Lord closed her womb. It's enough for God to close your womb. It's much worse that your neighbor will remind you that you are not even worth it. All this church where they go, where to take they do. Praise the Lord. So it was year by year when she went up to the house of the Lord that she provoked her. Therefore she wept and did not eat. When others are eating, you are crying. Then Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? And why is your heart grieved? Am I not better to you than 10 sons? So Hannah arose after they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh. Now Eli, the priest, was sitting on the seat by the doorpost of the tabernacle of the Lord. And she was in bitterness of soul. Bitterness of soul. And prayed to the Lord and wept in anguish. Then she made a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if you will indeed look on the affliction of your maidservant and remember me and not forget your maidservant, but will give your maidservant a male child, then I will give him to you all the days of his life, and no razor shall come upon his head. And it happened, as she continued praying before the Lord, that Eli washed her mouth. Now Hannah spoke in her heart. This is one area on the line. How can somebody speak in their heart, not with their mouth? Hallelujah. Only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore, Eli thought that he was strong. I'd like you to stand up. You know, one of the things I learned from this scripture is that until situation torments you to the point where your mouth cannot speak, only your heart can speak. I don't know how you know that the voice of the heart can be louder than that of the mouth before God. Ask God to bring you in a situation where you can no longer do anything but cry unto him from your heart. Penina was important to bring about the answer to Hannah's situation. Tell God, whoever you are going to use to bring me to my knees until my request is made, Jews, it doesn't matter. Whatever you are going to use, whoever you are going to use, Lord, bring me to my knees until my request is what? Answered. Let's pray. Make that prayer. Lord, help me. That is what everything what my brother has shared today is that God answers prayer. But he's a sovereign God. And if you don't submit to his sovereignty, you may torture yourself to death and nothing happens. Lord, help me. Whatever you are going to use, help me, bring me to a place where my prayer will be answered. I'm not hearing your voice. You are not talking to me. Thank you, Father. Help us, O Lord. Help us, O Lord. Help us, O Lord. Help me to come to a place where situations and circumstances will bring me to my knees and will hear the burdens in my heart. Thank you, Father. 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 In the name of Jesus. The next prayer point before we round up, these prayer points we are going to expand on them towards the end of the month prayer. This week is the last week, last days of the month. Whilst Hannah was praying like a drunkard, Eli was looking at her.
Praise the Lord. Our God is good. It was coming like a prophecy. I started there. You have been on this mountain for too long. You have been on this mountain for too long. You have been on this mountain for too long. You have to move forward. You have to move forward. You have to move forward. I am a God that do not lie. I know the end from the beginning. You have been on this mountain. Move and enter this mountain of praise. And on this mountain of praise, look back. Look back. Just like the songwriter that says, count your blessings. Begin to count your blessings. Count your blessings. Count your blessing. Look back from where you are coming from and where you are today. Is it by what you earned? Is it by your hard work? Just count. Count my blessings upon you and begin to praise me. Give me a name that is specific to you. To some people, I'm Jehovah Jireh. Some I'm Jehovah Shalom. Some I'm Jehovah El Gibor. Some I'm Jehovah Thy Healer. Jehovah Rapha. If you know that particular point where I met you, call me by that name. This week, be on Praise Mountain. And give me a name that is just for you. And you will know that indeed I've been working in your life. Where you are today, I brought you to the point. And I know where I'm taking you to. And I will take you to that place. And you will get to that place. All you need is put your eyes on me. Bring back yourself. Refocus. Refocus. Focus on me, and I will see you through. Just like I have done in the past. Just begin to enumerate all the difficulties, the situations, the pitfalls, the near misses that I brought you through. When you do that, you will not have a moment to doubt of my love. You will not have a moment to speak the word that I have disappointed you. Just be on Praise Mountain. That is the key. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. I want to confirm what she has shared. I thought it was personal. I believe it's all of us. You come out of your sobbing corner and celebrate me. I am the God of time and season. It is a season to celebrate His love. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I don't know who is expecting a brand new car, but I saw a brand new car.
Praise the Lord. This is a month of giving birth. Amen. Lord, we receive that new, brand new car. Preferably black car. Amen. Black is royalty.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Okay. Since my son has started with a car, let me just go there before I go to other places. There was one of the days the message came that if you are believing God for a car, go where mommy parks their car and pray. I don't know how many of us have done that. I am among the people that do it, and I can testify of what the Lord is doing. I am among the people that God has blessed with a new car. And more cars are still coming. And I had it like saying, don't allow anybody to park their car there until mommy comes, because there is still speaking. If you are still here, you are believing God for a new car, please go and tap your goal. The anointing is still working. I am a testimony of that. Amen. Then let me start from when our brother started preaching. At that point he said, if you are asking God for something and it looks as if it was not coming, leave it and start looking for people, you will solve their own problem. This preaching repeated when people were coming out that they are being disappointed. And the question was coming out. Let me confirm one more mission. He said, write 10 things where I have disappointed you, and write 10 things where I have blessed you. See if you will not find it difficult to write 10 things where I have disappointed you. But you can write 50 on what I have done for you. Say, learn to appreciate. On that process, I was showing, it looks like a mortuary. But I saw three groups. One was from 10 to 30. The other one was 30 to 60. The other one was 60 to 100. He said, look at those people. They are the mortuary. But your life is a great testimony. He sent his son to die for us. He said, and we are saying that we are not happy with him. Shake yourself. Say, you are the one holding your miracle. You are the one holding your testimony. He said, go. I have speak to you concerning that situation. But you are there holding yourself. May we learn this evening on how to obey God. See, everything we are doing tied on obedience. Obey me when I speak to you, and you will see the prophecy and the testimony of what I am doing in your life. Then when praise started, I saw this brother, the one that lived in is it praise or so, that sometimes plays chitta, the one in the choir. Okay. I saw, that's one that gave testimony last time when that he was not feeling fine then. Get healed. Yes. During the time he was singing, I saw a very beautiful flower being given to him as well. And immediately he received that flower, what I heard him say was, this is peace of what I have been looking for. So the Lord is giving him peace that he has been looking for. Then as praise is going on, that was when Sister Rebecca took over. The anointing was so much in this ministry. And that time, the Lord has showed me something. He said, in making bread or making cake or making a meat pie, he said, there is a point the fire will leave the outer body and start roasting the inside things. He said, this is what happens in the worship. Learn how to know when to enter, when the fire has lit the outer body and enter inside. Say what you want at that time, you will get it. See, at the time the praise goes high, you will see that the environment has changed. Learn how to speak a word into that environment and you will see the answer of it. Don't allow your angel on assignment to pass you by that time. Because during that period, I saw angels of God moving around, looking for who can say something. They are ready to take what we have said. Praise the Lord. Then, for the people that came out, I had a clear sight. write 10 things where I have blessed you, and write 10 things where I have disappointed you. Bring it to the altar. Intercessors will take it and handle it. See, after intercessors have handled that, see those things as a testimony. May God help us. And one of the things the Lord was saying about disobedience, say, one of the days, announcement was made, give your offering in envelope. And many of us are not obeying. And you expect him to receive it. He said, it is normal that every member of your family will come. You can make it as one family, put it in an envelope. When you give in that without envelope, he said, it has been spoken. It is no more a seed. You are on your own. This is where many of us miss it. When a prophecy is being given, carry it out. Praise the Lord. I have a good news for our sister, Sister Pat. I saw about 3 trailers going to Rubobuta to your compound. One carry chickens, one carry rod, one carry cement. Get ready for that upstairs. Amen. Then I was giving Psalm 76, verse 11. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord! Psalm 76, 11.
Praise the Lord. I just want to confirm the car this morning. When my quiet time, man, my eyes were just open. I saw the brand new car, black Honda. It was specific. Black Honda. It was specific. So when they said they're black, I was crazy.
Praise the Lord! I hope you are encouraged tonight. Amen. How many of us came to the altar and answered the altar call? The Lord gave all of us Habakkuk chapter 2 verse 3. Habakkuk 2:3. Can we have it on the slide? For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it will speak, and it will not lie. Though it tarries, wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I thank God for this word, because God never fails. In the time, Joseph was a bit discouraged, but what God spoke concerning him came to pass. Am I correct? Those of us that want to see wind and fire to consume the sacrifice, if it didn't come, say, who waits, will surely manifest. May the name of the Lord be glorified in the name of Jesus. Amen. Somebody else got, my children, I have not disappointed you. Those of us that felt being disappointed, God is telling us, and he is the only one that have disappointed us, or rather, we are the ones that have disappointed him by the lives we live. May the Lord help us to retrace our steps in the name of Jesus. Psalm 76, verse 11. And we have only had it on this line, and it was there before. Make vows to the Lord your God and pay them. Let all who are around him be present to him, who ought to be feared. God is the one that is ought to be feared. Brother Charles said something when we are asked to put our offering in an envelope. Maybe some of us have not done that. He will help us. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Before we take our offering, I know our prayer. Brother Matthew made mention the end of the morning prayer between Wednesday and Thursday, am I correct? Okay, Thursday and Friday, beginning and end. I want us to really dig into that prayer we made before in 2 Samuel chapter 8. That in this month, though it will tarry, but they concluded that it will not tarry. That was the last sentence in that Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 3. Because it will surely come. Now he said, it will not tarry. He said before, though it tarry, but now he said, it will not tarry. Your appointed time will not end. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let's pray that our offering. I want you to speak to that your offering. That this scripture in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 3 will be activated and be made manifest. Your time of visitation will not tarry. Let's lift our offering in thanksgiving. Lord, we bless your holy name. First of all, offer ourselves to you. And we declare that we are yours and yours alone. We lift up our substance, our offering, our vows and tithes to you. We ask, O God, may you be pleased and acceptable unto you in the name of Jesus. As we have obeyed you, O God, according to your word, in Malaga, we ask that you open the windows of heaven, even in this moment of giving birth, and pour upon us such gifts that our houses cannot even contain, even as you have visited Sister Pat tonight. So shall it be for each and every one of us in the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.